Good morning and welcome back to our new session on cryptographic hash functions. In this session, we are going to discuss about what hash functions are, and what are the cryptographic hash functions. Is there any difference between these hash functions and cryptographic hash functions? And we will also discuss the properties of the cryptographic hash functions. And finally, we will see some of the examples of cryptographic hash functions. And we will also see the applications of these hash functions. These are all very simple topic. We might have come across these hash functions topic in the hashing that is related to the data structures. We will once again discuss what these hash functions are and what are the properties of these hash functions and what are the various applications of cryptographic hash functions. All these things we are going to discuss in today's session. Coming to the basic definition of the hash function, a hash function is nothing but a function which maps the variable length message into a fixed length hash value. So, if you take a hash function like this, assume that this is a box where you are implementing the hash function, it takes input as a variable length message. And the output will be a fixed length value, and this fixed length value we are calling it as the hash value. So, it is a very simple definition. A hash function is nothing but a function, a mathematical function, you can make use of it, which converts the variable length message into a fixed length value, which we call it as the hash value. We can also call this hash value as MD. MD stands for the message digest. If you consider these hash functions, every hash function that you are going to use, they make use of one particular function which is called as the compression function. So, this variable length message will be larger than this fixed value, that hash value. That means the input is larger than the output. In order to convert the larger input to the smaller outputs, so we know we should have a technique which is called as the compression, where you are compressing the large number of bits into fixed number of bits. Therefore, that is the reason why we are saying that virtually all cryptographic functions involve the iterative use of one important function, which is called as the compression function. And coming to the discussion on this compression function, as I told that it is going to be the main functionality of this compression function is to compress the bits from large number of bits to the fixed length of bits. And the compression function used in the secure hash algorithms falls into two categories. The first category is a function which is specifically designed for the hash function, or it can be an algorithm. The second one is the algorithm. That is based on symmetric block cipher. We know what is this symmetric block ciphers are. They are going to use the same key for both encryption and decryption. So, the compression function, the main important component that is present inside this hash function is nothing but the compression function, and these compression functions fall into these two categories. It can be a function that is designed for a hash function, and it can be an algorithm also. For example, if you take the function category, you can say that SHA, we can short form, we call it as SHA. SHA stands for secure hash algorithm. And the example for this algorithm based on this symmetric block cipher is Whirlpool. These are the two examples that we can quote under these two categories of compression functions. With this basic idea on what this hash function is, let us see what the author is saying. So, a hash function, which is denoted by H, it accepts a variable length block of data M as input and produces a fixed size hash value. This is what I told, right? We have a hash function, input is variable length and the output will be fixed length. And the hash function is denoted by the letter H. The entire expression can be given like this. So, the output H is equal to the hash function that is applied on the variable length message M. And there are number of hash functions that can be used for getting the hash values, but there are two different properties that should be satisfied by a hash function in order to call it as a good hash function. The good hash function has the property that results of applying the function to a large set of inputs, and the outputs should be evenly distributed and they should be apparently random. So, whatever values you get, so the output here is nothing but H. The output what you are generating by applying the hash function onto the message should be evenly distributed. So, the H value should be different, and they should be evenly distributed means you have a output space like this. Assume that it is an array output space, and whatever values that it results, they should be placed evenly like this. In the next coming slides, we will discuss what a collision is also, right? For example, I have an output space of 4. Assume that when I apply the hash function, I get the H1, for example, H of one message M1 is resulting H1. I place this H1 here, let us assume like that. And I have another block M2, and if I apply M2 over here, hash function over M2, assume that the same hash value has been generated. That means it is mapping with this particular location. And this type of condition where two different variable length messages or blocks are going to generate the same hash values, it is called as the collision. A good hash function should not have collisions, but remember that it is impossible to completely avoid the collisions. We can say that a hash function is good hash function if the number of collisions is reduced. If a hash function satisfies these two properties, then we can say that it is a good hash function. And the principle Objective of the hash function is the data integrity. This is one of the service, that is the security service that we come across in the cryptographic algorithms. Data integrity stands for the ability to receive the correct message from the sender. For example, the sender has sent m bits, and if the receiver receives these m bits that is sent by the sender without any modifications or without any replaying like that, then we say that the message is satisfying the property of data integrity. Integrity means not able to modify the bits in during the transmission of the message from sender to receiver. The data integrity also checks that the change to any bit or bits in the M is nothing but the message, the variable length block message. A single bit change in M will result in generating a different hash code. So, this H can be called as hash value, or it can be called as hash code. Simply we can call it as codes, and they can also be called as MD, which stands for message digest. So, data integrity is the property that is satisfied by these hash functions. It means that a small change in one or more bits in the original message will result in generating a different hash code. These are the two properties that should be satisfied by the hash function. Now let us see what are these cryptographic hash functions. Previously, we have seen what a hash function is, very simple technique, and what are these cryptographic hash functions. The topic is very simple. So, when the hash functions are applied for the purpose of security, or for the purpose of cryptographic, or for the purpose of achieving the security services, then we call such hash functions as the cryptographic hash functions. So, the definition goes like this, that it is a kind of hash function that is needed for the security application and is referred to as the cryptographic hash function. The properties of the cryptographic hash function. Previously, we have seen the properties of hash functions, which says that the hash values should be evenly distributed and they should be apparently random in nature. In the similar fashion, there are different properties that should be satisfied by the cryptographic hash functions. The first one is the one-way property. The one-way property means we know that the hash function is like this, and we have the input, variable length input, and we have the output, which is nothing but hash value. Input is M, right? This is hash function. One way property says that from the input, when we apply the hash function on the input, we are going to get a hash value, fixed size hash value. But the reverse cannot be occurred. That means if we have the hash value and if we apply the inverse of hash function, it is impossible to get the original message. This is what is called as the one-way property. There is only one way. From input, you can generate the output, but you cannot apply the inverse of the hash function on the output to generate the message M. So, it is highly computationally infeasible to find a data object that maps to a pre-specified hash result, which is called as the one-way property. And the second property is the collision-free property. I told you what a collision is. when one or more objects, when two or more objects, sorry, one two or more objects are able to generate the same hash value, that we are calling it as the collision. But the cryptographic hash function should be designed in such a way that collisions should be avoided. But remember that the term avoiding the collision will not happen in the real world. So you should always concentrate to reduce the number of collisions. And if collision occurs, there are number of collision resolution techniques like separate chaining, linear probing, quadratic probing, all these things we will come across in the concept of data structures. So when two data objects that map the same hash value, that is called as the collision property, and you should achieve a cryptographic hash function such a way that it is collision free. So it is computationally infeasible to map two objects with the same hash result. Similarly, it is computationally infeasible that an object maps to a pre-specified hash result. These are the two properties that should be satisfied by the cryptographic hash functions. Because of these characteristics, the one-way property and the collision-free property, hash functions are used to determine whether the data has been changed or not. So, whether the data has been changed or not indicates the security service, which is nothing but the integrity. Data integrity. So remember, everything is the hash functions are being used to check the integrity of the data that is being transmitted from the sender to the receiver. With this basic idea of what a hash function is, what are the properties of a good hash function, and what are these cryptographic hash functions are, and what are the properties that a cryptographic hash function should satisfy, like the computational one-way property and the collision-free property, we will move into the applications of the hash functions, cryptographic hash functions. Remember that our topic of interest is towards the cryptographic hash functions. That means, we are going to discuss about the hash functions which are applied to the security applications like the cryptography, right? And remember that the cryptographic hash functions, this one, the cryptographic hash function is the most versatile cryptographic algorithm. We have lot of cryptographic algorithms, right? Out of all these cryptographic algorithms, these cryptographic hash functions are most versatile. Versatile in the sense they can be applied to a wide variety of applications. They can be applied to a wide variety of different concepts, or they can be applied to a wide variety of protocols, internet protocols. That is the reason why we say that the hash functions, the cryptographic hash functions, are the most versatile. They can easily adapt to anything. They can easily adapt to any cryptographic algorithm. Most versatile cryptographic algorithm. So it is used in a wide variety of security applications and internet protocols. Let us look at, because of this versatility of these cryptographic hash functions, we have lot of applications for these cryptographic hash functions. Let us look at one by one. We have different applications like the message authentication. Message authentication is something that provides a service called as the data integrity. It will check whether the bits has been changed during the transmission or not. Another application what we have under this cryptographic hash functions is digital signatures. There is nothing much difference between these digital signatures and this message authentication. We will see what is the minute difference that we have between this message authentication and the digital signatures. And after these digital signatures, we have some more applications like one-way password files. Similarly, these cryptographic hash functions can be used for intrusion detection. They can also be used for virus detection also. And some are applications like they are used for PRF, which stands for pseudo random function. Pseudo random function. Similarly, they are used to in the PRNG, which stands for pseudo random number generator. Right. PR stands for pseudo random, F stands for function, and PR stands for pseudo random, and NG stands for number generator. These are the various applications we have for these cryptographic hash functions. Because of the versatility property that the cryptographic hash functions are having. Let us look at these applications one by one. Initially, we will see what these cryptographic, what this message authentication is. I told that it is the most versatile cryptographic algorithm we find in the entire cryptographic subject is the cryptographic hash functions. The first application is the message authentication, which is a mechanism. The message authentication is a mechanism or a service that is used to verify the integrity of a message. This is what I told earlier. It is being used to verify the integrity of the message. Integrity in the sense it ensures that the data is not being changed during the transmission. If it is changed, it will simply alert the user. So, it assures that data received are exactly as sent, whatever data that is sent by the sender, it is exactly received. This is what is assured by this message authentication. That means, it contains no modifications, no insertion of additional data, no deletion of the already existing data or no replay attacks. That is what the integrity is. So, in message authentication, the function value is often referred to as the message digest. I told you, right? So, when we have a hash function, it input is the variable length message and the output is a fixed value. And this fixed value output can be a hash value or a hash code or it can be a message digest also. But in message authentication, we refer these hash function values as the message digest, a simple terminology that you should remember. But in many cases, other than this integrity of the message, in many cases, there is a requirement that the authentication mechanism assures that the identity of the sender is valid. That means whether the message has been received from the valid sender or not, from the genuine sender or not. This is also verified with this message authentication. How we are going to create these hash values and how these hash values are being used for this message authentication? There is a procedure which the sender and receiver has to follow. Very simple procedure, what we will see with the diagrams also in the coming slides, but at this particular point you just remember these terms. So, what the sender will do is he or she will compute a hash value as a function of bits in the message. So, whatever message we have, this is the message I have, I will take entire message and I apply the hash function onto it. The resultant will be a hash value h. And finally, what I will do is, what sender will do is, he will combine or he will concatenate these two values. That means, द आउटपुट हियर इज नथिंग बट द मैसेज एम कंकैटिनेटेड विद द हैश वैल्यू एच। एंड द कंकैटिनेटेड मैसेज एंड द हैश वैल्यू विल बी टेकन एज द मैसेज दैट इज सेंड बाय द सेंडर। एंड एट द रिसीविंग साइड द रिसीवर हैज टू परफॉर्म द सेम कैलकुलेशन। सो द रिसीवर विल बी गेटिंग दिस एम कंकैटिनेटेड विथ हैच। ही विल परफॉर्म द सेम कैलकुलेशन ऑन दिस एम। So M is again passed to H, which results in H, and whatever this H value is there, that is received from the sender, it is compared with the newly created hash value. If both the hash values are equal, then the receiver can assume that the message has not been modified. The receiver has received the same message what is sent by the sender. This is how it is going to work. But if there is a mismatch, the receiver knows that the message has been altered. So this is how the original hash cryptographic hash functions are used for the purpose of message authentication. So we have different examples under this message authentication category. Let us discuss what is happening here. So these are the various examples of the use of hash function for message authentication. The first example discusses how we are going to provide the confidentiality and authentication. Remember that when you come across the term authentication, it is nothing but you are using the hash function. When you come across the term confidentiality, remember that you are using the concept of encryption at the sender side and decryption at the receiver side. Let me denote the encryption as E and the decryption as D. This is one of the example where you are providing both the services, both the confidentiality and the authentication. But authentication is done by making use of hash functions. Confidentiality, you can make use of any cryptographic algorithm, and you can encrypt it at the sender side and decrypt it at the receiver side. The second example what we are going to discuss is only authentication service is being provided. So only hash function is used, and we are not providing the encryption and decryption here in this case. And the third example is the secret value authentication. We know that authentication is based on hash functions, okay. But what is this secret value authentication means? There exists a secret value S, which is nothing but some type of message, which is being shared by the receiver and the sender. And in performing the authentication or in generating the hash value, both the sender and receiver will make use of this shared secret value. That is the reason why we are calling this category as the secret value authentication. And the last category is very simple thing, which is an extension where we are providing the secret value authentication along with the confidentiality. So we will make use of hash functions for the authentication. Since it is secret value, the sender and the receiver will be sharing the two shared secret values, and confidentiality means it includes the encryption and decryption. These are the four examples which we are going to discuss with the diagrammatical approach. The first example, the message authentication, both confidentiality and authentication, right? Here you can see that this particular part is source A, and this is from here to here, it is destination B. At the source end, the message M is taken and it is given as input to a hash value H. This is not hash value, it is hash function, sorry. So it is given as input to hash value h. The resultant is nothing but a hash value. Let us denote it with small h, which is nothing but hash function applied on the message m. And the result h is, you can see this one, this is nothing but a concatenation operator. So concatenation is nothing but m concatenated with h of m. Right. That means after the entire message is being inserted, you will add the hash value at the end of the message. This is the meaning of concatenation. And this message, which is you are concatenating this message and hash value, that is being encrypted with a common K value. So this is nothing but symmetric key cryptography. So this key is common for encryption and decryption. You can see here the destination N, the same key K is used. Therefore, this is nothing but the symmetric key encryption. And this entire message is being encrypted, which is converted into the ciphertext, and the resultant block you will get here is this one, which is denoted by, you see here, encryption. E stands for the encryption algorithm. The message that is being encrypted is m concatenated with h of m, and we are making use of the key k. So it is denoted as e of k comma m concatenated with h of m, like this. This ciphertext is being transmitted to the destination. And at the destination end, it has to do the reverse process. Here at the source end, the last step is encryption. Therefore, the first step that should be performed at the destination should be the decryption. You will perform the decryption with the same key. Therefore, we are calling it as the symmetric key. When we perform the decryption on this ciphertext, you will get the plain text. Therefore, you will get m like this, and this is nothing but h of m. That means this is m concatenated with h of m. You will receive this after you decrypt the message. And as I told that at the destination end, the receiver has to perform the hash function again. So this h at the destination is same as that of the h that is used at the source. The destination, the receiver will take this m and he will apply the hash function h of m. The result will be h of m. And he will perform a comparison operation of the newly generated hash value with the hash value that is already present inside this one. If both of these values are equal, then we can say that the message is not altered. The data integrity property is satisfied. Assume that some bits have been modified here during the transmission. When you calculate the hash function on this message, you will get a hash value h dash of m, which is not equal to h of m. Therefore, you can say that the message has been altered during the transmission. This is what the message authentication is. It is going to provide the data integrity. It is going to check whether the data has been modified during the transmission or not. You can see here that authentication is provided with the hash function, and confidentiality is provided with the encryption. When we go to the next example of the message authentication, which provides only authentication, so there is no need for the encryption and all these things. Right. So you take the message at the source side, you take the message, you apply the hash function, And remember here that you are going to encrypt the hash value. We are not encrypting the entire message, we are not providing the confidentiality to the message. We are providing the confidentiality, or we are converting the hash value such that this hash value, even though it is received by an attacker, he cannot get any information related to the hash value. So, the output here will be h of m, and the output here will be e of k comma h of m. And now we are concatenating the message with the ciphertext of hash value. So, whatever output I will get like this, this is m and this is nothing but e of k comma h of m. And that message is transmitted, and at the destination side message again you will apply the hash function, and you will get a value called h of m, let us say h dash of m. And for this one you have to decrypt it with the same key, therefore we are using the symmetric encryption here, and here you will get it as h of m. Now compare this h of m with the new value h dash of m. If they are equal, then you say that the message is not altered. If they are not equal, you can say that the message is altered. Here you can see that only the hash code is encrypted. Here you are encrypting the only the hash code using symmetric encryption, k and k here. The advantage of this particular implementation is it reduces the processing burden of those applications that do not require the confidentiality. So, confidentiality means you are going to have more burden. That means the receiver has to decrypt it, he has to perform the decryption. So, everything it involves a lot of burden. So, for this purpose, in order to reduce the burden of processing on the receiver, what you are going to do is you are just skipping the confidentiality part for the entire message. But remember that you are going to provide the confidentiality, or the encryption is provided for the hash function. The third example what we have is the secret value authentication. See here, at the sender side I have a message m, and you can see here that the message m is concatenated with s. So, the what I will get here is m concatenated with s. This s is nothing but a secret value that is being shared by the two communicating parties. It is a common shared secret value. For the original message, you are going to append this secret value, and for that message you are going to apply the hash function. Now, I will get the message output as h of m concatenated with s, like. And I am appending this h of m appended with s with m. So, the output what I will get here is m concatenated with h of m concatenated with s. This is transmitted, and at the destination side the message is taken, and again I will calculate the hash value by appending the secret value. We know that the secret value is already shared between these two parties. Now, I will get m concatenated with s, and here I will get h dash of m concatenated with s. This is again h of m concatenated with s. Compare these two values, h dash of m concatenated with secret value and h of m concatenated with secret value. If they are equal, the message is not altered. If they are not equal, the message is altered. The reason why we are using this secret value authentication is it is possible to use the hash function, but no encryption for message authentication. वी नीड टू शेयर द सीक्रेट वैल्यू एस बिटवीन द टू कम्युनिकेटिंग पार्टीज. सो दिस इज हाउ द सीक्रेट वैल्यू ऑथेंटिकेशन इज अचीव. द लास्ट एग्जाम्पल इज नथिंग बट सीक्रेट वैल्यू ऑथेंटिकेशन and confidentiality. Whenever you have confidentiality, you just apply the encryption, that's it. So this particular part we have seen in the third case, that is C. You take the message, you concatenate with S like this. Here you will get the output as H of M concatenated with S, and here I will get it as M concatenated with H of M concatenated with S, and we apply the encryption, you will get like this. See here, encryption of, you are using the key K on the message concatenated with H of message concatenated with S. And since you are providing the encryption here at the receiving side, the first step that the receiver has to perform is the decryption. He will make use of the same key, which is nothing but the symmetric encryption, and he will get the message like this. It is M concatenated with H of M concatenated with S. So this is M and this is H of M concatenated with S. For the message, you apply the concatenation with S, which is already shared between the communicating parties, and you generate and you pass it to the hash function, you generate H dash of M concatenated with S. This is H M concatenated with S. Compare when they are equal, when these two values, hash values are equal, the message is not altered. But if they are not equal, they are altered. The message is altered. And here most of the cases we have seen that authentication along with confidentiality in case A and in case D, last one. The first and fourth examples we have seen consists of confidentiality. Confidentiality means you are going to you are not going to expose the data during the transmission, that is the confidential. We know very well about this. But there are some requirements, most of the cases you don't require this confidentiality. So when confidentiality is not required, the method B, see here, this one, this is having an added advantage over the other methods, which are nothing but A and D, that is message authentication with confidentiality and secret value authentication and confidentiality. The B is having advantage over the other methods, which encrypts the entire messages. See here, for this case A, you are encrypting the entire message, that means message concatenated with H of M. And similarly, in the last case, message concatenated with H of M concatenated with S, you are encrypting it. So the entire message is being encrypted. This makes the, or this puts the burden on the receiver side. More computational resources has to be used to decrypt this message. The advantage of using only authentication, that too you are encrypting only the hash value, is having more advantages than providing the confidentiality to the entire messages. That is, you have less computations that are required for this case when compared to that of case A and case D. And there are lot of scenarios where you are the others or the scientists, they are trying to avoid the encryption. There are some particular reasons why we need to avoid this encryption. Here you may get a doubt that what if the message has been received by the other. But here we are checking whether the message or the data integrity is achieved or not. वी आर जस्ट चेकिंग वेदर द मैसेज इज रिसीव्ड एज इट इज आर नॉट और वेदर एनी ऑल्टरेशन हैज बीन डन बाय द रिसीवर. So in most of the cases, we don't require this encryption. That means we are going to avoid the encryption. There are a lot of reasons for this. The first reason is the encryption software is relatively slow. So whatever encryption software you take, whatever algorithm you take, that is relatively slow. That means it is going to take more time to perform the encryption or to perform the decryption. Though the amount of data to be encrypted per message is small, even though you have very small message to be encrypted, it is going to take lot of resources from the sender side. Similarly, it is going to take lot of resources from the receiver side in order to perform the encryption and decryption. And another disadvantage we have with this encryption and decryption is encryption hardware costs. It is not cash, it is costs. So the cost of the encryption hardware is not negligible. That means there is some cost escalation when we make use of these encryption hardwares. We have seen in DES and AES, we are going to use a very low cost chip implementations of DES. But even though you are using the low cost chips, the cost of the overall encryption hardware will be somewhat greater. If you combine all the nodes, and if all the nodes includes this encryption hardware, even though the cost of one single node is very less, when you accumulate this particular cost of the encryption hardware for the entire network, which consists of some n number of nodes, it costs very high. And another disadvantage why we are not using this encryption, why we are avoiding this encryption, is encryption hardware is optimized towards large data sizes. That means for small blocks of data, a high proportion of the time is spent in initialization or invocation overhead. So this hardware what we have for the encryption and decryption, they are optimized for large data sizes only. So when the inputs are large, the hardware is optimized, therefore it will run with very less time. But if the input is small, since the hardware is not optimized for these small data sets, it will take lot of time. And another disadvantage, another drawback with these encryption algorithms is the encryption algorithms are almost patented. Every algorithm is patented. And when you want to make use of those patented algorithms, you need to pay some few bucks to the original author. So there is a cost that is associated with licensing their usage. Because of these particular reasons, the encryption is not a preferred technique in the case of message authentication. Right. So once we are done with the first application, which is nothing but the message authentication, let us move our discussion into the second application, which is nothing but the digital signatures. Very simple and a minute change occurs during these digital signatures when compared to that of the message authentication. You can see that both of them are almost same, but for digital signatures, they are going to make use of the private keys. Basically, what we have seen in the earlier examples of message authentication, we are going to use, that means the sender is going to use a key for the encryption, a key K for the encryption, and the same key K will be used for the decryption also. But when we are going to use these particular concepts under the application of digital signatures, द एनक्रिप्शन इज परफॉर्म्ड बाय द प्राइवेट की ऑफ द सेंडर and the decryption will be sent will be used will be done by making use of the public key of the sender. This is the only difference we have. Other than this, this is almost similar to that of the case 2, this one, where you are taking a message m, you are applying the hash function, we will get h of m, and you are encrypting it with the key. The resultant is encryption of k comma h of m, and you are concatenating with the original message. But instead of the common key k, which is common for both the source and the destination, if you use the private key of the source, which is nothing but a, and for the decryption you are not using this k, you are using the public key of a, then this is nothing but the digital signature. So for signatures, remember that for signatures you have to use your private keys. If you are a sender, you have to use your private key, and if you are a receiver, you have to use the other party's public key. Very important difference that you should observe here. So coming to our discussion again, the digital signatures, the operation of the digital signature is similar to that of a MAC. MAC is nothing but message authentication code. So the most common message authentication is nothing new here, right? It is nothing but a message authentication is always achieved using a message authentication code, which we are calling it as MAC, which is also called as the keyed hash function. So the MAC is otherwise called as the keyed hash function. And typically these MACs are used between two parties that share a secret key to authenticate information exchanged and produce a hash value referred to as the MAC. So these MACs are used between these two parties which share a common secret key to authenticate the information exchange. This is all about the MACs. So we are not bothered about this MAC. You just remember that MAC is nothing but a message authentication code, which is used for message authentication. That's it. Nothing more than that. It is something similar to that of a hash function, keyed hash function. Coming back to our discussion of digital signatures again, the digital signature, the operation of digital signature is similar to that of MAC. How you generate the MAC is almost similar to that of generating a digital signatures. But in case of digital signatures, the hash value of the message is encrypted with the sender's private key. This is very important. See here, we have, this is at source A, we have a message M, which I am passing it to hash function. The resultant will be h of m, and this hash value is encrypted with the private key, therefore it becomes like this, private key of a comma h of m. And now you are going to concatenate this message with the encrypted part of the hash function like this. This is transmitted, and once it is received at the receiving end, the destination, what it will do is, the receiver, what he will do is, he will take this message part, again he will apply the hash value, and he will get some h dash of m, let us say. And at this point I have the encrypted part of h of m, so I have to decrypt it. And for decryption, you can observe that we are using the public key of A. It is not the public key of B. Always remember that digital signatures always concentrates on the sender side. It gives more emphasis on the sender. Sender has to put the signature based upon the private key. And the same thing can be verified at the sender side with the public key. It is reverse of the encryption technique what we have discussed in the asymmetric key encryptions. So for encryption, remember that we are going to use, I'm just retrieving back what we have discussed in the encryption. So So in the encryption side, when we want to use the asymmetric encryption, you will encrypt the entire message with the public key of the receiver. So the receiver has more emphasis here. And once it is encrypted, the receiver, he can make use of his private key and he can decrypt it. But it is a reverse case for the digital signatures. For the digital signatures, more emphasis is given to the sender. So the encryption of hash code is done by making use of the private key of the sender, and the decryption of the hash code will be done by making use of the public key of the sender itself. After this, I will get h of m. I compare this h dash of m with h of m. If they are equal, the message is not altered, and if they are not equal, the message is altered. So this is where it is providing the concept of message authentication as well as the digital signature. And for example, let us say and who is responsible for knowing this integrity of the message? Anyone who knows the users, the sender's public key, can verify the integrity of the message that is associated with the digital signature. So anybody who knows the public key of the sender, he can verify the integrity of the message along with the digital signature. In this case, listen carefully. In this case, an attacker who wishes to alter the message would need to know the user's private key. For example, assume that there is an attacker here, sitting here, and he gets this message. He can get the message, and he cannot get this hash value. Why? Because the hash value is encrypted with the private key of the sender. So it is completely ciphertext, which is not known to the attacker. In order to know this h of m, he should know the private key of the sender, which is impossible. So the private keys are almost highly confidential, which is not shared to the others. So for this purpose, the h of m is impossible, the learning of the h of m is impossible. No attacker can learn about this h of m without knowing the private key. Let us see another example. Here we are going to provide the confidentiality as well as the digital signatures. The same concept, we take the message, apply the hash function, I will get the h of m. And since it is digital signature, you encrypt the hash value with the private key of the sender. So I will get the message like this, PR of A, comma h of m. I will concatenate it here. And I will encrypt the entire message. This m concatenated with the encrypted hash value will be completely encrypted with the public key k, or it is the shared key. And that I will get the message like this, encryption of the k with the message m concatenated with the ciphertext of hash value. And at the receiving side, the receiver has to first perform the decryption with the key, where he will get the m along with the encrypted part of this one. And again, the decryption is performed with the public key of a, so that he will get h of m here. And here he will get h dash of m. Compare these two values, and if they are equal, both of them, the message is not altered. If it is not equal, then the message has been altered. This is how the integrity will be checked by making use of the digital signatures. So once we are done with the second application of the digital signatures, let us go with the other applications, like as I told that one way password files, very simple concept, very simple concept. So we have different passwords for different files. Let us assume that we have n number of files in the operating system and every file is having the password. It is a common practice that one will store these passwords inside a file and he will store it somewhere in the CD-ROM or CD writer, or he will store it in a pen drive. But once if the pen drive is lost where he is storing all the passwords of different important files, everything is compromised. In order to avoid such type of loss of passwords, there is a concept called as one-way password files. One way, whenever you hear the term one way, you remember that it is nothing but a hash function. So what you are going to do is, you are going to take the passwords of each and every file, apply the hash function to the passwords of each and every file, and you are going to generate the hash values for different passwords of different files, right? So we have, let us take an example. We have file 1, we have another file 2, we have another file 3, like this. And we have passwords P1, P2 and P3. Instead of storing this P1, P2 and P3 inside a file like this and storing it inside the pen drive, what you will do is, you will apply the hash function onto this P1, you will get some hash value H1. Again, you apply the hash function on P2, let us assume that H2 is the hash value. You apply the hash function on P3 and the output is H3. Instead of storing these passwords P1, P2 and P3, you will store the hash values H1, H2 and H3 like this. So this is called as the one-way password files. You are going to store the hash values inside a file, therefore we are calling this file as the one-way password file. And you are going to store it inside a CD-ROM or a CD disk, anything you can make use of it, nothing wrong in it, right? Even though the attacker gets this particular one-way password file, as I told that the cryptographic hash functions always have to satisfy the one-way property. That means, if you know the password, you can generate the hash values, but the reverse cannot happen. If you know the hash files, you cannot generate the passwords. Because of this important one-way property, you can store the hash values and you can share it to anyone, no worries. You share it to your friends, this particular one-way password file. They can never retrieve back these passwords. That is the power of these hash functions. Right. So, even though the attacker gets access to this password file, he will never get to know any password. And again, how we are going to check whether the password is correct or not? For example, if I want to open this file F1, I will type this password P1. What the system will do is, it will apply the hash function to this P1 and it will generate a value H1 dash. And this H1 dash and H1 is compared. If both of them are equal, then the file will be opened. If they are not equal, the file will not be opened. So this is how you are going to make use of these cryptographic hash functions to generate the one-way password files. So a hash of a, let us see what the other is saying. A hash of a password is stored by an operating system rather than the password itself. This is what I told. The actual password is not retrievable by a hacker even though he gains access to the password file. I told it, because this is possible because of the one-way property, that is possible with only the cryptographic hash functions. And when a user enters a password, the hash of that password is computed and it is compared to the stored hash value for verification. If both are equal, the file will be opened. If both are not equal, the file will not be opened. And this is the most commonly used technique in most of the operating systems. So in operating systems, we are not going to store the passwords directly inside a file. Instead, we are going to apply the hash functions and we are going to store the hash values, which we are calling this technique as one-way password files. Very simple and very powerful technique. Other than these one-way password files, we have something called as the intrusion detection. So, if a new user enters into our system, how we are going to verify it? So, HFF of each file on a system is stored and secure those hash values on one CD reader. One can determine if a file has been modified by recomputing HFF. So, every file, previous example only, every file you will apply the hash function here and you will get some hash value H1. Similarly, for file F2, apply the hash function and you will get the output as H2. You will store all these H1 and H2 inside one file. When you want to determine whether file 1 is modified or not, you again recompute the hash function on this F1, file 1. You will get a value called H1 dash. Compare this H1 dash with the value already stored here. If it is equal, then it is not modified. If it is not equal, the file has been modified. So, this is how the intruder detection can be made, right? Can be performed. So, an intruder would need to change the file F without changing the H of F. Similarly, it can be used for virus detection. The cryptographic hash functions can be used for construction of pseudo random functions, which in short form we can call them as the PRFs, which is used for generation of symmetric keys. And it is also used, it means the cryptographic hash functions are also used for pseudo random number generators, which we will make use of this random number generators in some of the cryptographic functions. Or in some of the programming part also, we will make use of these PRNGs. So, let us wrap up this session and let us have a quick recap of what we have discussed in today's session. We have started our discussion with the simple definition of a hash function. What a hash function is. So, a hash function is nothing but a function which accepts a variable length block of M as input and produces a fixed value, which is called as hash value or hash code, or it is also called as message digest. We have n number of hash functions, out of which we can call only few functions, hash functions, as good if it satisfies the following properties. The output, the hash values what we are generating should be evenly distributed and they are random in nature. So, the main important objective of these hash function is to provide the data integrity. Data integrity in the sense it will verify whether the data that has been sent by the sender has been received correctly without any modification during the transmission or not. This is called as the data integrity. And after that, we have gone through the cryptographic hash functions, where some set of hash functions which are applied for the security applications, we are categorizing them as the cryptographic hash functions. And the properties of the cryptographic hash functions are very important. That is the one-way property and the collision-free property. One-way property means you can generate the hash value from the message, but the reverse, that means generation of message if you know the hash value is impossible. And similarly, the collision free property, that means no two objects cannot fall or cannot result the same hash value. And these properties are used to check whether the data has been changed or not, which is nothing but the integrity property. And after that, we have seen the applications of cryptographic hash functions, like the message authentication. We have seen what the message authentication is, how it is going to happen with these four examples, where the first example provides both the confidentiality and the authentication service, and the second example provides only authentication, The third one is the secret value authentication, where you will have a secret shared value S that is shared between the sender and the receiver. And finally, you have the secret value authentication along with the confidentiality. Remember that authentication makes use of the hash functions and the confidentiality makes use of the encryption and decryption process. And sometimes you require the confidentiality, and sometimes in most of the cases confidentiality is neglected, is avoided. Why? Because the encryption software is slow, the encryption hardware is less, but when you combine it on the entire network, the cost will be somewhat high. And the encryption hardware is always optimized on the large data sizes. So if you make use of the small data sizes, it takes a lot of time. Similarly, the encryption algorithms are all patented, so you have to pay some few amount to make use of those licenses. Because of these reasons, one is trying to avoid the confidentiality service. You can avoid the encryption in order to reduce the burden of encryption and decryption at the sender and the receiver side to save money and time. And the next application we have seen is the digital signature. It is almost similar to that of message authentication code, but you are going to encrypt the hash value by making use of the private key of the sender, and at the receiver side you are going to decrypt it by making use of the public key of the sender only. And confidentiality and signature, this one we have discussed. And one-way password files, where you are going to store the hash values of the passwords. And because of the one-way property, it is impossible for the attacker to gain the passwords even though he knows all the hash values. And similarly, the same is the case with the intrusion detection and virus detection, PRNG and PRF. So that's all for today's session, and we'll meet with some new topics of these hash functions in the next coming sessions. Thank you one and all for joining the session.